Hey, what's up guys? Jeremy here from RoboDK. Welcome to the tutorial series covering the main components of RoboDK. Today's topic is long overdue. I'm saying that because a good chunk of the questions we receive on a daily basis are related, at a certain degree, to that topic. I'm talking here about the reference frames. They can be heaven if you know how to use them, but they will be hell if you don't. Okay, let's get started. So today I'm starting with an empty station. To understand the basis of the reference frame concept, we don't need a robot. We will add one later in the process. So before going further, we need to clearly define what is a reference frame. In a few words, I would say that it's a coordinate system that lets you place item at a specific 3D position with respect to an origin. What I mean by item is either a target, an object, a robot, or another reference frame. Let's try to define those words with images. First, go to the main menu and select Add Reference Frame to create a new reference frame in your station called Frame 1. Don't forget that you can use the slash key to show or hide item names. Double-click the reference frame in your station tree to show the details. By the way, you can also double-click directly on the coordinate system 3D representation in your station. This window is pretty simple compared to the rod panel we've seen a few tutorials ago. We simply have the name of the reference frame, so here frame 1. Then we have the visibility checkbox. And underneath that, we have the frame position. First, we need to know with respect to what this position is given. In our case, it's pretty simple. We have nothing but the reference frame in our station. So considering that, our reference frame position is given with respect to the station origin, or the station 000. To show you that, let's simply move the reference frame by changing the X value. Let's put 200 millimeters. The small coordinate system that you are seeing right now is the origin of the station. So our reference frame, frame 1, is positioned at 200 millimeters along the station X axis. Okay, let's reset that. Obviously, I can do the same along the Z and the Y axis. I'm pressing Alt and using my mouse to move the axis around. Okay, and the same is also true for the rotation. Okay, let's reset that again. And now let's import an object. Open the online library, go to object, and select the cube. To be more precise, the name of this object is in fact box. Let's start by drag and dropping the box in our frame 1. As you can see, the box is now nested with the reference frame, frame 1. It means that the box is now part of frame 1. We call that relation parent and child. So frame 1 is the parent and box is the child. Now, one important thing to know is that the origin of that object is in the middle of the cube. So the 000XYZ of the box is right in the center of it. Double-click the object to show its details window. So again, we have the name of the object and its visibility checkboxes. So now if we look at the object position with respect to, we can see that the selected item is frame 1. This is completely normal, because as I just said, the object box is the child of frame 1. Just below, we can see that the position is filled with zeros. This again is normal, it just means that the object box is positioned at the origin of frame 1. Now we need to understand something in the relation parent-child. The child will always follow the parent movements, but the parent won't follow its child movements. So if I decide to move the frame 1, the box will follow me everywhere, in translation and in rotation. Okay, let's reset our frame position. But if I decide to modify the box position this time, let's say by manually putting it at 150 millimeters on X and same thing on Y, the box moved, but the frame didn't. Now the object detail window shows us that the box origin is positioned at 150, 150, and 0 in terms of translation and was not modified in terms of rotation. All that again with respect to the reference frame origin. Now if I modify the position of frame 1, let's say we go for the same movement again, 200 millimeters along X, the object follows as we could expect. If we look at the object position, with respect to frame 1, nothing has changed. We still are at 150, 150, and 0. But if I click on the drop-down menu and I change the object position with respect to from frame 1 to new station, which in other words mean with respect to the station origin, we end up with a different value. Those values are the sum of the transformation between the station origin and the frame 1, which is translation along X, and the translation between the frame 1 and the object box, which is a translation along X and Y. There is no theoretical limit to that parent and child relation. We could decide that we want a new reference frame, frame 2, that is a child of frame 1. And let's copy and paste the object box. I will change the name for box 2. And I will change the color to differentiate both objects. Let's use a green, for example. We can move the frame 2 around to make sure that the parent-child relation between it and the green box is correct. Okay, perfect. Let's look at our station 3 to better understand the parent-child relation. Frame 1 has two children, the first one being the gray box and the second one being frame 2. So if I move frame 1, everything is following, but if I move frame 2, frame 1 and the gray box are not affected. Then one level below we have frame 2 who has one child, which is the green box. Now that we understand the concept of reference frame, let's create three examples where they are incredibly useful. Okay, I'll open the first example. Here we have a system that takes range from a table and drop them in one of two bins. We created 12 different targets to reach every part. Let's say that for some reason the station design must change. Let's say that the table must move not much, maybe 200 millimeters in that direction. I'll start by showing you the worst case scenario. Here, every object was placed with respect to the station origin, and every target was thought with respect to the reference frame of the robot. In that situation, I would have to manually modify the position of every part, including the table and the rack holding the part in place. So double click on the table, modify the position, 200 millimeters, close it, double click the jig, modify the position, close it, and you do that another 13 times. Afterward, you need to manually modify the position of the targets. Select a target, press F3, modify the position, and then close it. Again, you need to do that 12 times. It's already painful and the modification is quite simple. We didn't ask for a 45 degrees rotation of the table. You would need to calculate the X and Y position at every part and enter them manually. Okay, now let's see what it looks like if we use the reference frame. I have the exact same station here. The only real difference is that I have a reference frame called frame table and a reference frame called frame bin. If we look at the parent-child relation here, the reference frame frame table has no parent, but the station. Considering that, its position will be calculated with respect to the station origin. It has two children, the object table and the reference frame frame wrench. The reference frame frame wrench has many children. There is the rack holding the part in place, the parts themselves, and all the targets to reach the parts. Now, if I want to move all that stuff 200 millimeters in that direction, I simply need to modify the value of the reference frame, frame table, and everything will follow. So no need to modify the position of the object nor the targets. They will stay at the same position with respect to reference frame table. We only modify the position of frame table. So it literally took me 5 seconds and we are ready to go. So same thing if I need to rotate the part 90 degrees but keep the table in place. This time, instead of moving frame table, I will move frame wrench. So let's rotate 90 degrees around Z. Adjust the X and Y values if needed. Then voila, much faster. Okay, next example, we are using the same station again. This time I won't show you the worst case scenario. I think that you guys get it. Now that my first working station is ready, I won't create two more that are exactly the same, but one position here and one position there. So instead of creating a new reference frame, importing a new table and a new rack, importing and positioning the parts and creating the targets, I can simply select the frame table, copy it and paste it twice. As you can see, it took all the children of frame table and copied them. I can now rename the frame table for frame table 1, frame table 2, and frame table 3. Same for the frame wrench 1, frame wrench 2, and frame wrench 3. Now we can rename the targets. If you remember the basic guide series, you don't need to rename them all one by one. You can select a group of targets, right click and select rename group. So let's say T wrench 1. Do the same for T wrench 2. And for T wrench 3. The only thing we need to do now is to properly locate the frame table 2 and 3. So the number 2 will be placed somewhere around here with a rotation of 90 degrees. And the number 3 will be placed with a rotation of 180 degrees. Perfect. That was quite fast. Okay, let's jump to the last example. In this station, the robot needs to follow different paths on different parts. If we jump in SolidWorks, we can see three different models of part. We have one with a triangular path, one with a circular path, and that kind of rounded rectangular path. Okay, if I go back to RoboDK, those parts all need to be placed at the same spot on the table. So here, in a folder, I have the step version of the three parts. Let's look at the worst case scenario. I drag and drop one part. By default, it's imported at the root of the station. Now, I need to double click the object, select Show Object Reference Frame, then move the object a bit and use the Alt and Mouse method to position the part. If you need to import a new part, you will do the same. The process will be repeated for every single part that is imported in the station. But if I jump in the other station here, it's the same thing, except that I have a reference frame called frame part positioned on top of my table. Now, if I drag and drop a part, it will be imported by default at the root of the station here. Nothing surprising so far. But if I go in the station 3 and that I nest the object with frame parts, the object will be moved at the right position. I can do the same for every single object. So the second one here, and let's go for the third one. Pretty cool, right? There's only one important thing to do for this trick to work. I'll delete the parts and I'll go back to SolidWorks. It's important before saving your part as a step file or exporting them with our CAD plugin to make sure that the part origin is at the same place for every model. As you can see, for this example, the origin of the part is always here. Now that I talked about it, let's take 10 seconds to use our SolidWorks plugin. Just be aware that SolidWorks is not the only CAD software that we support. The complete list is available in our online documentation. If I open the RoboDK plugin tab and select settings, I can enter the name of the part when imported, let's say part SW for SolidWorks, and below that I can choose to which reference frame I want that part to be imported. So here I can write frame parts. Click OK, and now I simply click load part. Now I can reopen RoboDK, and the part was imported directly where I wanted it. I think that is a pretty cool feature. Okay, that's pretty much everything for that tutorial. I really hope it was helpful. If you think it was, please hit that like button and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We are frequently releasing new material and you clearly don't want to miss any new tricks. The next video of this series will be covering the topic of targets. Have a good day, guys.